fathers, sisters, and all parishioners, people of our zone. We are all gathered here this evening to celebrate a very joyful event. And when there's a lot of joy, I hope you have heard what I have said already, so I don't repeat. We are all here as a family to celebrate a very joyful event. One doesn't require a person's face. So when my heart is full at this beautiful celebration, we are all joyful. Why is this joy? Much more than happiness, than merrymaking, than what you call a grief, mirth, and so on. It's much deeper than that. And what is this joy? Let's say when we have a tsunami, outwardly there would be a lot of disturbance, but inward there is deep calm and peace. This is what happens at Christmas for us. External celebrations, cards, greetings and whatnot, and not to forget the cake and the kalakans and the sweets, but there's much deeper joy within. And why this joy? Joy to the world is a hymn that carries some joy to heaven. Joy to the world. Why? The Savior is coming. And that's the reason of our joy. We have a lovely time because the Savior is come. He comes to us. And when He comes, definitely He doesn't come empty-handed. As in the Hail Holy Queen, the prayer we say, we are poor, banished children of Eve. After that sin, where we were banished, now the Savior comes to redeem us. Whoever we are, whatever we are, whatever our position, the Savior comes to redeem us. From what? From our sin, from our day-to-day problems. Not that He's going to solve all our problems and remove all our problems, but He gives us that deep joy within, by means of which, along with the Lord, we can solve all our problems. That this is the time for this deep joy. The Savior is coming. The first and second readings of today give us ample reasons why we need to be happy and what is the Savior going to do in our lives. I'm not going to enumerate all the reasons because we need to pay attention to the first and second readings, which spell out very clearly what is this joy, what is the Savior going to do in our lives. But before I leave, I want to tell you that we are redeemed by the Lord from our slavery to sin, and therefore we all rejoice. I wish every one of you a really joyful event of Christmas. Not merely the external celebration, but deep spiritual preparation. We take a lot of time to decorate our houses, our convents, and dress up very well, and meet friends, greet them. How much time do we really spend to prepare ourselves to be internally joyful? So I invite every one of you at this event that we are much ahead of Christmas, and yet we need to take time to prepare ourselves to be joyful. So we ask the Lord's special grace to give us all that He has brought us to give and to prepare ourselves, and John the Baptist tells us. Saint Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. In spite of all the tribulation, he said, who can separate us from the love of Christ? I rejoice and I want everyone to rejoice. And therefore, with Isaiah and Paul in front of us, let's take the example and try to prepare ourselves really well so our Christmas does not become merely a happy Christmas, a merry Christmas, but a truly joyful Christmas.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you all. Christ Jesus, as we are in the third week of Advent, the Church asks us to rejoice. The entire liturgy makes us to feel that Christ Savior is already in the midst of us. And we have been preparing to receive the Lord. Let us thank the Lord for having given us this beautiful opportunity of coming together this evening, especially from the community who live in the Basparam Nagar and Srinivas Nagar, along with the religious people. I request all of you to join in this celebration and let us have this celebration in such a way. God, accept this Eucharistic sacrifice. Let us recall to our mind the sins and failures, and let us ask God's pardon and forgiveness. I confess,
Almighty God, and to my brothers and sisters, that I have been sinning in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have already done, through my faults, through my most grievous faults. Therefore, I ask the Lady of Mercy, all the angels and saints, and to my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to God.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Of so great a salvation, and to celebrate them always with solemn worship and glad rejoicing, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Prophet Isaiah invites the people in exile to rejoice despite all their trials and sufferings, because the Lord will certainly come to their rescue and lead them back to their homeland. A reading from the book of Prophet Isaiah. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For water shall break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. And the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. The word of the Lord.
Christians to be patient while waiting for the coming of the Lord, just as the farmer waits patiently for his crops to grow. Second, a reading from the letter of St. James. Be patient, therefore, my brethren, until the coming of the Lord. Behold, the farmer waits for the precious fruits of the earth, being patient over it, until it receive the early and the late rain. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble, brethren, against one another, that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the doors. As an example of suffering and patience, brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah. The Lord is with you.
And with your spirit.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Saint Matthew.
Matthew chapter 11 verses 2 to 11. When John heard in prison about the deeds of the Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you he who is to come, or shall we look for another?" And Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is he who takes no offense at me." As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to behold? A reed shaken by the wind? Why then did you go out to see a man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, those who wear soft raiment are in king's houses. Why then did you go out to see a prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet, this is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, who shall prepare thy way before thee.' Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there hath risen no one greater than John the Baptist. Yet he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." The Gospel of the Lord.
My dear brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus, as we heard in the introduction, we have come here to rejoice, as the reading of the day tells us. We are come here to rejoice because the Lord is already in our midst. My dear friends, one day in a country park, a group of teenage boys were playing basketball. A tall, bald, like me, African-American man walked inside. And the man watched the boys playing basketball for a few minutes. Then he asked the permission so that he can join the play. And the boys gladly allowed the man to play. And this man, black, bald, African-American, played for 15 minutes. And he gave marvelous shots. All three-point shots he was shooting. After playing 15 minutes basketball, he called the boys once again and gave few tips how to play basketball. And he walked away without telling who is he. And the boys came together and said, "Who is this man?" without telling his name and going. Could it be Michael Jordan, the legendary basketball player? If it is Michael Jordan, what on earth is he doing in our remote village? My dear brothers and sisters, the village boys were unable to accept that the legendary basketball player Michael Jordan was with them. In the same way, today John the Baptist has a problem in the gospel. He sends two of his disciples. You need to know this. The Pharisees had their disciples. John had his disciples. Jesus also had his disciples and apostles. This distinction we read in the fourth or fifth chapter of the Gospel of St. Luke. Jesus spends one full night in prayer, comes down in the morning, called his disciples, and from those disciples, he called 12 and named them as apostles. So three of them had the disciples. Only Jesus had 12 apostles. Now, John sends two of his disciples asking this question to Jesus. Are you the one who is supposed to come, or are we supposed to wait for somebody else? Was John right in asking this question? I want you to react. Was John right in asking this question? Yes or no? Some people say, Father Sagai Raj, after going to the college, he treats everybody like students. That is not the case. Okay. I pose this question to you because, according to the Gospel of St. John, chapter 1, verse 29 and 30, it is this John the Baptist who pointed out and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Am I right? It is this John who told the people, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." And today, what made him to send two of his disciples to go and ask, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for somebody else?" Is my question logical or not? Now, the answer is also given by John the Baptist. John the Baptist says in John chapter 1 verses 31 we read, John is telling the people, "I myself did not know who is this Lamb of God. I myself did not know who this Lamb of God. But the one who sent me to baptize with water, the one who commanded me to baptize the people with water, had given me a sign." What sign it is? John, in the process of baptizing people in the River Jordan, there will be one man on whom the Spirit of God will come down and rest in the form of a dove. Catch that man. He is the Savior. He is the Messiah. And when John gave baptism to Jesus, remember that word is very, very important. When Jesus comes along with the people to receive baptism, John tries to prevent Jesus. "Jesus, I am supposed to receive baptism from you. How can you come to me?" And Jesus said, "John, for time being, please keep quiet. We have to fulfill certain obligations." And when Jesus received baptism in the River Jordan and came on the shore, the Spirit of God came upon Jesus, and John identified, yes, what the Father said is happening in Jesus. Therefore, from the knowledge he received from the Father, we can call revelation received from the Father, John said, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." And therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, John pointed out the Messiah to the world, not out of his personal experience with Jesus, not out of his personal encounter with Jesus, like Peter or like Paul on the road to Damascus. He pointed out Jesus to the world from the knowledge he received from the Father. And therefore, the second important point is this. According to the scripture, you know, John beautifully says, last Sunday's gospel we heard, the axe is already laid on the tree. Any tree that does not bear fruit will be cut off. And his winnowing chaff is with him. Which means John was projecting a Messiah who will be very strict. John was projecting a Messiah who will be very, very just. John was projecting a Messiah who will be very fierce in his approach. But in the prison, John gets to know that this man called Jesus is becoming very mild, very loving, very compassionate. And therefore, does this quality of Messiah coincide with the Messiah prophesied long ago? He had his doubt. And secondly, my dear brothers and sisters, according to the 61 chapter of Isaiah, we read, the role of the Messiah was to give sight to the blind, make the lame walk, make the dead to get back to life, cleanse the leper, and also to liberate the prisoners. Very clearly given to us in the what do you call that? When Jesus goes to Nazareth, when they give him the scroll of Isaiah, he opens and reads, and the line is like this: "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, to give sight to the blind, to raise the dead, and to set the prisoners free." And therefore, John in this prison expected Messiah to do something to get him out of the prison, and Jesus was not doing anything. And therefore, John had this question: is this the Messiah or should we wait for somebody else? And my dear brothers and sisters, when the disciples of John came and asked him, Jesus never said, I am the one. Jesus never said, I am the one. Jesus simply said, go and tell John what you see and what you hear. My dear brothers and sisters, very often in our life, we are also like John the Baptist. We fix time frame for God. For example, I need this particular favor, therefore I will make Novenatus St. Anthony 13 days or 13 weeks. Within 13 weeks, God has to answer. Otherwise, I get upset about it. Isn't it? I pray this has to take place. For example, it is a beautiful joke is said, once a man fully drunk, okay, got a lottery ticket, 5 crores lottery ticket. And after fully drunk, he came to the church of St. Anthony. Life-size statue was there. In full intoxication, he said, Anthony, tomorrow is the draw. If I don't get 5,000, I'll break you into pieces. He was fully drunk. So parish priest heard this one. He got scared. Tomorrow, if the fellow break the statue, I cannot get one more, okay? So what happened? Overnight, he removed the big statue and kept a small statue. Okay? So next day morning, the man came. He did not get the lottery. Therefore, he came again fully drunk. And he saw a small statue. He said, in Tamil, he said, Yangada Oppa, means, where is your daddy? So something like that. No, we always fix, you know, how God has to act. We recently concluded the year of faith. My dear brothers and sisters, faith is this, as we read in the book of Habakkuk. The author says, Lord, even if my land does not produce fruits, produce paddy, even if my trees don't give apples and oranges, okay, my stall is empty of cattle, okay, I get any negative response, even then, Lord, I will believe in you, I will trust in you. And therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, John, to say, was unable to accept Jesus the way Jesus presented himself. Therefore, let us examine our conscience and see, do I ask God to act in the way I want? Or do I allow the Lord to take me according to his plans and desires? My ways are not your ways, nor my thought your thoughts. As the heaven is high above the earth, there is so much of difference between your thinking and my thinking. Now, John the Baptist's disciples go and report him, dear John, this is what Jesus said. Go and he asked us to go to come and tell you what is happening there. What is happening there? The blind is seeing again, the lame are walking again, good news is proclaimed to the poor, lepers are cleansed, dead are raised. And therefore, John in the cell starts meditating. And in his meditation, John gets to know, according to Isaiah 35, 1 to 6, these are also the works of Messiah. Among all the works of Messiah, liberating the prisoners is one of them, not the only one. Not the only one. And therefore, from then on, we see John coming down, calming down, and accepting the will of God in his life. Later on we see he will be killed for standing for truth. Therefore, as we are getting ready to celebrate Christmas, my dear brothers and sisters, let us ask a simple question. First and foremost, do I accept the will of God in my life? Do I accept the will of God in my life? It is very easy to identify Jesus in success. Very easy to identify Jesus when you are in the peak of glory. Very easy to accept Jesus when everything goes well. But when things don't go well, my dear brothers and sisters, it is very difficult to accept Jesus. And secondly, action speaks louder than words. They say in English, action speaks louder than words. Does my action tell the people of Shastri Nagar or Padmarav Nagar that I am a Christian? I may have a star. I may have a star. Okay. I may have a very big star. Okay. I may have a crib outside. I may have a Christmas tree. Those things will indicate even Chandana brothers also have Christmas tree. Okay. Even RS brothers also have Christmas tree. But what is that differentiates you and I? And Jesus says, You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. And let your light shine before people so that seeing your good works, they may give praise to your Father in heaven. Does my action portray that I am a Christian? Finally, my dear brothers and sisters, one word about today's first reading. God is telling us, go and tell my people, comfort them, comfort my people. Strengthen the weak knees, strengthen the shivering hands, because I, the Lord, am going to visit you. Remember, this message was given to the people of Israel when they're slaves in the land of Babylon. God sent them as slaves to Babylon to teach the lesson, because once they settled down in promised land, they forgot 10 commandments, they started worshipping other gods and goddesses. So God had to teach them a lesson. Remember, as the coin has two sides, okay, the God also has two sides, the justice of God, the mercy of God. So in the book of Isaiah, we read, in a fraction of a second, in anger, I punished you, but I will embrace you with an everlasting love. And therefore, the third Sunday of Advent, we are called to rejoice because God is coming to us as a God of compassion. Sometimes, my dear brothers and sisters, because of various influence, especially because of influence of listening to too many TV preachers, we are not able to understand that God is compassionate. It may be a repetition for some of you, but good things are good to repeat. It seems one day, a child came back from the catechism class and told mother, Mommy, today my catechism sister told me God is very loving, God is very kind, God is very compassionate and all those things. Mommy is from old school. Mommy is from old school. And the mommy said to the child, which stupid sister told you? Because God sent water, rain, 40 days and 40 nights and destroyed the entire earth. And he sent sulfur and brimstone on Sodom and Gomorrah and destroyed that country. How can such a God be a loving and compassionate God? Go and tell the sister to learn catechism properly before teaching. And the child was inspired to tell, now listen carefully, the child was inspired to tell, Mommy, that was before God could become a Christian. Okay, that was before God could become a Christian. And we are preparing ourselves, my dear brothers and sisters, to meet that compassionate God. Definitely not on 25th. Okay, the season of Advent is given to us to prepare for the second coming of Christ. Let us take this lesson very seriously in our life. Very often we think season of Advent is given to prepare for Christmas. And if our sister pointed out, we remain outside only. But remember, for the priest today, the morning prayer, scripture reading is very, very beautiful in the breviary. The salvation is closer at hand now than we first began to believe. Beautiful statement, breviary in the morning prayer. The salvation is closer at hand now than we first started to believe. And therefore, every Christmas is just telling us that as Jesus came to this world as a baby, maybe 2013 years ago, he will come again. That's what every Sunday we say without knowing. I believe that he will come to judge the living and the dead. And therefore, when that Jesus comes, am I ready to accept him? Or will he find me acceptable? Otherwise, my dear brothers and sisters, everything is of no use. Finally, I conclude my homily with this anecdote. It seems once a man was going in the country boat from one shore to the other shore. A boy was rowing, and the man was a very big pandit. Okay, and he asked that boy, "My dear boy, do you know Ramayanam?" And the boy says, "Sorry, sir, I don't know Ramayanam." And the pandit was very ridiculing type and said, 25% of your life is gone. After some more distance of rowing, and the pandit asked the boy, do you know Mahabharata? He said, sorry, sir, I don't know Mahabharata. 50% of your life is gone. Okay? And after some more rowing, okay, he said, do you know something about Bible? No, sir, I don't know anything about Bible. That means 75% of your life is gone. And meanwhile, the boy noticed there was a hole in the country board, water was coming inside. Sir, do you know swimming? I don't know. 100% life is gone. And therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, let us remind ourselves, what does it profits a man if he gains the whole world and suffers the loss of his soul? In the busy schedule of decorating and preparing ourselves externally, let us never miss the mark. Scripture says the final word, the book of Revelation, behold, I am coming soon, and the reward of each person is coming along with me. Amen.
And then proclaim our faith. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
Prayer of the faithful. Dear brothers and sisters, the Father who loves us so much has to give away his only Son, Jesus Christ, for us. Will not certainly hold back anything we might ask him in faith. With this confidence, let us bring our prayers and petitions to him, saying, Father, hear our prayer.
Father, hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for our Pope Francis and for our entire Catholic Church, that all of us strive together towards holiness and share the joy of Christmas to those around us. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, we bring before you all those who are gathered here, that during this season of joy, may our families experience peace and unity and may transmit the same. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, we pray for all the poor and needy who are incapable of meeting their daily needs. May your birth be a sign of hope to face the daily challenges, to experience satisfaction in their day-to-day lives. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the peace in the world, as you are the Prince of Peace, who alone can bring harmony to this troubled world. We ask you that may your birth once again bring comforts and consolation to the suffering humanity. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we bring before you all the youth of today. May your graces be upon them to discover your plans. May they use all their talents, abilities, and their vigor and innovative spirit to proclaim to the world your kingdom at your birth. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all the sick and sufferings. Believing in your power, may they experience your healing touch. May they have the courage to accept the reality of life and patience to bear the sufferings with love. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for our parish priest, Reverend Father V.K. Swami, who celebrates today the 33rd anniversary of his priestly ordination. Bless him to grow in holiness and through his priestly ministry to touch the lives of many people and to lead them to the life of faith, hope and love. Along with him, we implore your favor upon all the priests, especially those who are at your altar today. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We shall bring forward our own personal intentions for our family needs and the community needs. God of mercy, take pity on our weakness May the coming of your Son and our Savior confirm our faith, strengthen our hope, and deepen our love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. That my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and good of all His holy church.
May the sacrifice of our worship, Lord, we pray, be offered to you unceasingly to complete what was begun in sacred mystery and powerfully accomplished for us your saving work through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For He assumed at His first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled and designed your form long ago and opened for us the way to eternal salvation, that when He comes again in glory and majesty, and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for the day may inherit the great promise in which now we dare to hope. And so were the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven. We sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise, for through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather your people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, giving you thanks, said the blessing. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed
Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation for the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity the broken church on earth with your servant Pope Francis, the Kampala Archbishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family gathered here, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, very especially Vedamuthu Adaikalamman, the father, mother of Adi Vikraswami, and to all who were facing to you at their passing from this world, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours.
Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body and blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life.
For the communion, kindly remain wherever you are. We will come there and distribute communion because the passage is too small here. Thank you.
Let us pray. We implore your mercy, O Lord, that this divine sustenance may cleanse us of our faults and prepare us for the coming feast through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless us, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.